Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Anastasia Krupnik by Lois Lowry, narrated by C.J. Critt. This work, copyrighted 1979 by Lois Lowry, is recorded by arrangement with Houghton Mifflin Company. This recording is copyrighted 1993 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Anastasia Krupnik is 10 years old. She's got the longest name in the fourth grade, and she writes down everything that's important to her in a green notebook. Suddenly, so much is happening, her notebook is filling up. And now, Anastasia Krupnik.
Chapter 1. Anastasia Krupnik was 10. She had hair the color of Hubbard squash, 14 freckles across her nose, and 7 others in places that she preferred people not to know about, and glasses with large owl-eyed rims, which she had chosen herself at the optician's. Once, she had thought that she might like to be a professional ice skater. But after 2 years of trying, she still skated on the insides of her ankles. Once, she had thought that she might like to be a ballerina. But after a year of Saturday morning ballet lessons, she still couldn't get the fifth position exactly right. Her parents said, very kindly, that perhaps she should choose a profession that didn't involve her feet. She thought that probably they were right, and she was still trying to think of one. Anastasia had a small pink wart in the middle of her left thumb. She found her wart very pleasing. It had appeared quite by surprise, shortly after her 10th birthday, on a morning when nothing else interesting was happening, and it was the first wart she had ever had or even seen. "It's the loveliest color I've ever seen in a wart," her mother, who had seen others, said with admiration. "Warts, you know," her father had told her, "have a kind of magic to them. They come and go without any reason at all, rather like elves." Anastasia's father, Dr. Myron Krupnik, was a professor of literature and had read just about every book in the world, which may have been why he knew so much about warts. He had a beard the color of Hubbard squash, though not much hair on his head, and he wore glasses for astigmatism, as Anastasia did, although his were not quite as owly. He was also a poet. Sometimes he read his poems to Anastasia by candlelight and let her take an occasional, very small, sip of his wine. Catherine Krupnik, her mother, was a painter. Very often there was a smudge of purple on her cheek, or a dab of green on one wrist or elbow. Sometimes she smelled of turpentine, which painters use. Sometimes she smelled of vanilla and brown sugar, which mothers use. And sometimes, not very often, she smelled of Je Reviens perfume. In the bookcases of their apartment were 4 volumes of poetry, which had been written by Myron Krupnik. The first one was called Laughter Behind the Mask, and on the back of the book was a photograph of Myron Krupnik, much younger, when he had a lot of hair, holding his glasses in one hand and half smiling as if he knew a secret. Anastasia's father hated that book, or said that he did. Anastasia sometimes wondered why he kept it in the bookcase if he hated it so much. She thought it must be a little like the feeling she had had when she was 8, when she hated a boy named Michael McGuire so much that she walked past his house every day just to stick out her tongue. The second book of poetry by her father had a photograph of him with slightly less hair and a mustache. It was called Mystery of Myth. Her father liked it, but her mother didn't like it at all. The reason her mother didn't like it at all was because on one of the inside front pages it said, "For Annie." Anastasia didn't know who Annie was. She suspected that her mother did. The third book was her mother's favorite, probably because it said inside, "For Catherine." It was called Come Morning, Come Night, and was filled with love poems that Anastasia found very embarrassing. But the fourth book was her favorite. Her father's photograph showed him bald and bearded, the way she had always known him. The poems were soft-sounding and quiet when he read them to her. The book was called Bittersweet, and it said inside, "To someone special, Anastasia." Sometimes, when no one was in the room, Anastasia took Bittersweet down from the shelf just to look at that page. Looking at it made her feel awed, unique, and proud. Awed, unique, and proud were three words that she had written on page 7 of her green notebook. She kept lists of her favorite words. She kept important private information, and she kept things that she thought might be the beginnings of poems in her green notebook. No one had ever looked inside the green notebook except Anastasia. On page 1, the green notebook said, "My name is Anastasia Krupnik. This is the year that I am 10. On page 2, it said, "These are the most important things that happened the year that I was 10. So far, there were only two things on the list. One was, "I got a small pink wart." And the other was, "My teacher's name is Mrs. Westvessel." Mrs. Westvessel wore stockings with seams up the back and shoes that laced on the sides. Sometimes, while she sat at her desk, she unlaced her shoes when she thought no one was watching and rubbed her feet against each other. Under the stockings, on the tops of her toes, were tiny round things like small donuts. Anastasia described the toe donuts to her mother, and her mother nodded and explained that those were called corn pads. Anastasia wrote "corn pads" on page 27 of her notebook. Mrs. Westvessel also had interesting brown spots on the backs of her hands, very large and lopsided bosoms, and a faint gray mustache. "I think Mrs. Westvessel is probably over 100 years old," Anastasia told her parents at dinner. "Probably about 120. "Nobody lives to be 120, said her mother, as she poured some mushroom gravy over Anastasia's meatloaf. "Unless they're in Tibet." Her father wrinkled his forehead. "Perhaps Mrs. Westvessel is a mutant," he said. "Yes," agreed Anastasia. "Mrs. Westvessel is a mutant, I believe." Later she wrote "mutant" on page 27, under "corn pads." Anastasia was a very good speller. She sounded out the syllables of "mutant" correctly on the first try. Anastasia didn't like Mrs. Westvessel very much. That made her feel funny, because she had always liked, sometimes even loved, her teachers before. So she wrote in her green notebook, Why Don't I Like Mrs. Westvessel? And began to make a list of reasons. Making lists of reasons was sometimes a good way to figure things out. Reason one, wrote Anastasia, because she isn't a good teacher. But then she crossed out reason one because it was a lie. Anastasia wasn't crazy about telling lies, even to herself. She did it sometimes, but it always gave her a stomach ache. Mrs. Westvessel, she knew, was really a pretty good teacher. At any rate, she had taught Anastasia to remember the difference between minuends and subtrahends, which was not a particularly interesting thing to know, and also how to say, I love you, in both French and German, which was not only very interesting, but might come in handy someday. Reason two, wrote Anastasia, after she had crossed out reason one, because she is so old. That wasn't a lie, so it didn't give her a stomach ache. But it was a reason that Anastasia felt a little strange about. Anastasia felt a little strange about old people in general. Probably it was because of her grandmother, who was the oldest person she knew. Her grandmother was so old that she lived in a nursing home, and Anastasia didn't like to visit her there. The nursing home smelled of medicine and Polident, a bad combination of smells. But Mrs. Westvessel smelled of chalk dust and Elmer's glue, which was not a bad combination at all. And Mrs. Westvessel, although she was old, never acted old. When they were studying Ireland and geography, Mrs. Westvessel had done an Irish jig in her laced-up shoes with her bosoms bouncing. That, thought Anastasia, wasn't an old thing to do. So she slowly crossed out reason two. Then she couldn't think of any others. Finally, she wrote, reason three, because I am dumb. Not dumb in school. Anastasia, particularly after she had finally mastered the difference between minuends and subtrahends, was actually a very good student. I'm dumb, said Anastasia sadly to herself. Because sometimes, too many times, I don't feel the same way about things that everybody else feels. I was the only one at Jennifer McCauley's birthday party, she remembered gloomily, who thought green ice cream was nauseating. Everybody even said I was dumb for that. I'm the only person in the world, she reminded herself. The whole entire world. Who likes cold spinach sandwiches. That's really dumb. And now, she thought, I'm the only kid in the fourth grade who doesn't like Mrs. Westvessel. So reason three seemed to be the reason. Because I'm dumb. She left it there, frowned, and closed her green notebook. Sometimes, she thought, maybe it isn't a good idea after all to make a list and find out the answer to a question. But when Mrs. Westvessel announced one day in the fall that the class would begin writing poetry, Anastasia was the happiest she had ever been in school. Somewhere, off in a place beyond her own thoughts, Anastasia could hear Mrs. Westvessel's voice. She was reading some poems to the class. She was talking about poetry and how it was made. But Anastasia wasn't really listening. She was listening instead to the words that were appearing in her own head, floating there and arranging themselves into groups, into lines, into poems. There were so many poems being born in Anastasia's head that she ran all the way home from school to find a private place to write them down. The way her cat had once found a very private place, the pile of ironing in the pantry, in which to create kittens. But she discovered that it wasn't easy. She hung the Do Not Disturb sign from the Parker House Hotel on the doorknob of her bedroom door. She thought that might make it easier. She got herself a glass of orange juice with ice in it to sip on while she worked. She thought that might make it easier. She put on her Red Sox cap. She thought that might make it easier. But it still wasn't easy at all. Sometimes the words she wrote down were the wrong words and didn't say what she wanted them to say, didn't make the sounds that she wanted them to make. Soon her Snoopy wastebasket was filled with crumpled pages, crumpled beginnings of poems. Her mother knocked on her bedroom door and called, "Anastasia, are you all right?" "Yes," she called back, taking her pencil eraser out of her mouth for a minute. "I'm writing a poem." Her mother understood that, because very often Anastasia's father would close the door to his study when he was writing a poem and wouldn't come out even for dinner. "Okay, love," her mother said, the way she said it to Anastasia's father. It took her 8 evenings to write one poem. Even then, she was surprised when she realized that it was finished. She read it aloud, alone in her room, behind the Do Not Disturb sign from the Parker House Hotel. And then she read it aloud again and smiled. Then she read it aloud one more time, put it into the top drawer of her desk, took out her green notebook, and added to the list on page 2 under "These are the most important things that happened the year that I was 10, as item 3, "I wrote a wonderful poem." Then she flipped the Do Not Disturb sign on her doorknob to its opposite side, the side her mother didn't like. "Maid," said the opposite side, "please make up this room as soon as possible." Her poem was finished just in time for Creativity Week. Mrs. Westvessel was very, very fond of weeks. In their class, already this year, they had had Be Kind to Animals Week, when the bulletin board had been filled with newspaper clippings about dogs who had found lost children in deep woods, cats that had traveled 300 miles home after being left behind in strange cities, and a cow in New Hampshire that had been spray-painted red during hunting season so that she would not be mistaken for a deer. During my neighborhood.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.